So our previous videos talked about vapor pressure and the different types of vapor pressure, actual vapor pressure and saturation vapor pressure. Just to review briefly, again, vapor pressure is a partial pressure that is a component of total air pressure. Air pressure is the force of molecules on a surface area. In this case, if we had a parcel of air, like you see here, like a model parcel of air, like an air mass, we could say that air pressure is the force of all of those molecules pushing against the surface area of that air mass, the surface area of the air mass. And we can break the total air pressure down into partial pressures of nitrogen and green molecules and oxygen and red molecules and water vapor and these molecules that look like Mickey Mouse ears. And there's also argon partial pressure and carbon dioxide partial pressure. There's a lot of partial pressures inside an entire atmospheric air mass. So these are, we are particularly talking about water vapor partial pressure, and we broke that down into atmospheric vapor pressure, which in a desert can be very low, around 1% of total atmospheric sea level pressure. And in a rainforest, it can be about 4% of total atmospheric air pressure. And we talked about the fact that this actual vapor pressure, we can remember it as actual and atmospheric, it's really directly dependent on water vapor levels in the air. And you either have a lot of water vapor or you don't in the air, and that really impacts the actual vapor pressure. When we talked about saturation vapor pressure, we talked about a specific like subset of actual vapor pressure. And this is a specific subset of the vapor pressure that comes to equilibrium on the surface of water. In other words, that equilibrium is the number of water molecules leaving as vapor equals the number of vapor molecules returning to the water and condensing. And this is a subset of the actual vapor pressure because it's going to be in on Earth somewhere between 10 and 40. And when we find that equilibrium pressure, which is going to be lower in cold waters and it's going to be higher in hot waters, we call that the saturation vapor pressure. This red line looks at temperature. It's totally dependent on temperature on the x-axis. You follow the temperature up to the red line, which is the saturation vapor pressure, and then you go to the y-axis and you find out what that vapor pressure is. So in the deserts, it's going to be somewhere around 10 millibars, and that's going to feel very dry for a hot desert when we've got very low water vapor. And then if you took that same temperature and went to the tropics, to a rainforest, you would see that the saturation vapor pressure, that equilibrium vapor pressure of vaporizing and condensing, is much higher at about 40 millibars of pressure. This is going to feel very, very humid. And that's what we're going to talk about next. We're going to talk about the fact that saturation vapor pressure really is the big part of our humidity calculation. So our humidity calculation, like we said, is really dependent on this saturation vapor pressure. Well, what is our humidity calculation and what does it have to do with saturation? You know that when it feels very humid outside, it feels like a wet sponge, right? And it's a really apropos visual to think about, because a moist sponge, when you squeeze it, it doesn't let go of any water. But a saturated sponge, when you squeeze it, really drips out water a lot. So we talk about a saturated sponge that can absorb no more energy. It's saturated with energy. It could be saturated with matter. It absorbs no more matter. What we really talk about here is this sponge, this atmosphere is saturated with so much water vapor that it can't take in any more water vapor. It is at its equilibrium point. So if you applied any squeezing or any pressure to this saturated atmosphere, it would just drip out water as condensation. So this is a really good mnemonic to think about the sponge as an atmosphere, and the sponge saturated with water vapor is a very, very humid atmosphere that can condense out water vapor very readily to form those thunderstorms in the afternoon. And in fact, the definition of relative humidity, RH, is that it is the pressures, or it is the calculation when the pressures are equal at evaporation and condensation. So when actual vapor pressure equals saturation vapor pressure, we note that the relative humidity is 100%. The air in the atmosphere is saturated just like the air at the surface of the water. So when evaporation vapor pressures equal condensation vapor pressures, we say the air is saturated, the atmosphere is saturated, just like the saturation vapor pressure at water surface. We say the relative humidity is 100%. Well, let's show you the calculation for that. And as you can really get a feel for this, I hate relative humidity, not only for how it feels, but I hate the calculation. So I am going to be spending about 5 minutes on this calculation, and then I am not going to mention it again in this class because I hate the calculation. The calculation of relative humidity is the actual vapor pressure in the atmosphere or in the air over the saturation vapor pressure in the air at the surface of the water. All right. So the relative humidity is a calculation of how close the air is to saturation. And I hate this because how close, that's such an objective measure. And I hate percentages because they are objective as well. And I hate denominators and I hate quotients and I hate dividing. So I hate everything about the relative humidity calculation. And what I need to tell you so that you understand a little bit more is that this relative humidity calculation has actual vapor levels or actual vapor pressures in the numerator. And that's fine because we know the only way to change the actual vapor pressure in the atmosphere is to go from one level of water vapor and then to just add in more water vapor. Just throw it into the container and then seal the container up tight. And we added vapor here, so the actual vapor level went up. So that means that this measurement in the numerator went up. So that meant that the relative humidity goes up as well. So that's fine, and that's easy to understand. But the point is that this doesn't happen often in our atmosphere. You don't just throw in water vapor into the atmosphere. The water vapor for the day or for 24-hour period doesn't normally change very much. So our actual vapor level is not really impacting our humidity level. What is impacting the humidity level is the denominator, the saturation vapor level. And you know, I hate denominators, but we have to look into it a little bit to understand it. If we want to look into the saturation vapor pressure in that denominator, we're going to be using this graph. And this graph is going to be dependent on temperature. So as the temperature goes up, the saturation vapor pressure is going to go up. And that means that you're putting a bigger number in the denominator. And when you put a bigger number in a denominator, it means the overall quotient is lower. And the overall quotient here is the relative humidity. And that means the relative humidity goes down because the relative humidity is a quotient. Well, that's confusing enough as it is, but you could stop the video here and go over that because that's just division and quotients and denominators. And the other part of this is that this denominator changes throughout the 24-hour period. So the temperature goes up during the day and the temperature goes down during the night. So the relative humidity really does change quite a bit as a result of this denominator and this temperature and this saturation vapor pressure. In fact, if you look at it, that as the temperature goes up during the day, the relative humidity in the green goes down. Now you might say that is crazy. It feels most humid at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. But in fact, that is because you're looking at or you're feeling a combination of the high temperatures of the day and the humidity. And that's giving you a real feel temperature. And that is what you're feeling. But the lowest relative humidity by calculation during the day is at the hottest time of the day. And conversely, and this is going to blow your mind, the highest humidity of the day is at the lowest temperature of the day, right at dawn. The lowest temperature of the day is right at dawn because you know that you're radiating off so much of the radiant energy from Earth, and you have so little energy around Earth at that time before the sun starts to shine again. That is your lowest temperature at dawn. And because that is your lowest temperature, that means it is your lowest saturation vapor pressure, and that means it's really low in the denominator, so that means the quotient is higher. Now, this is all very wacky in the calculations, and it doesn't make any difference. Well, it really impacts your real feel because you think that the humidity is highest in the afternoon, and it is not. It's a crazy calculation. And in fact, it really impacts on the other side, with those low temperatures, right? So I'll give you an example how this impacts with the low temperatures. It says hang your clothes outside to dry. But if it's too cold, remember, the temperature is down. If it's too cold, hang them inside on a drying rack. And the reason why you hang them inside on a drying rack is because the humidity is high when it's cool and you won't get your clothes dry. They won't. The humidity will be so high, there'll be so much water vapor in the air that it won't be able to take the water vapor off your clothes and dry them. So I hope that helps you a little bit to understand that relative humidity is a crazy calculation. And last but not least, and this will be the last time I introduce this into this course, relative humidity is actual vapor pressure in the atmosphere over saturation vapor pressure at the water surface. And it's dependent on temperature. It goes up as temperature goes up. But that relative humidity calculation is so crazy, it puts that in the denominator. And that means that as temperature goes up and saturation vapor pressure goes up in the denominator, it makes the quotient radiant relative humidity go down. It's just a crazy calculation. So I hope this has helped you in a way, and we're going to come up with a much easier solution and measure that I love so much more and that real true meteorologists use, and that is dew point, and that comes next.